live into the reality that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins. Friends, brothers and sisters in Christ, part of discipleship is receiving and believing the good news of the Bible. It is living into the forgiveness that we have received in, through, and because of Jesus Christ. Let us declare to one another, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
At this time in our service, we have Jared King, Donald Hansons. Maybe they are making their way down. They have a special blessing for our campers.
Good morning. Just want to send up a quick prayer for the campers that are going up to Gormley this week. So if you just bow your heads with me. Lord, thank you so much for this opportunity for our young campers to go up and enjoy the grounds of Gormley. So many others have before them. And we just thank you for all the blessings and the ministry that have come out of that camp and have been that and still is for our church. And so we just send up a prayer for safety and blessing on the kids as they travel up there, for them and all the leaders during the course of the week, that they would grow in their relationship with you and in their relationships with each other, and also meet new friends along the way. So we just thank you and praise you for all the possibilities this coming week. In your son's name, amen.
And Jean Evans will join us up here for a special blessing on our children's church.
It's time for children's Sunday school, pre-K through fifth grade. So we're going to meet right over here in the lobby, and we're going to walk you over to the CE building. Today we're studying John, his birth, Zachariah and Elizabeth, and what they experienced, and John's job in this world. And we'll bring you back at the end of service, too.
Every eye would see you. strong to save in your mighty name.
Scripture reading is Matthew 6, 9 to 13, and it's a little different than, since I'm a little older than this stanza, I'll read. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Okay, you can be seated. Thank you. I trust the scripture reading this morning was relatively familiar to you. We've all memorized that since we were children. And as I was doing my study for the sermon today, I know that the prayer was written for the disciples to pray, but we call it the Lord's Prayer. And I was wondering if when I go through my thing this morning, I'm probably going to say it's the Lord's Prayer, because just raised with that in your mind, it's the Lord's Prayer. But actually, It's a prayer for the disciples to pray, but we get back and forth. That just goes to show how that we can be raised thinking something about a passage of scripture, and we're getting it wrong, even though we know what it really means. So if we go through here and I kind of say the Lord's Prayer a lot, I'm talking about the prayer the Lord told the disciples to pray, because it's our prayer. And going through here, this is very familiar. And I'm going to try to break it down a little and maybe redefine to us something that might have slipped away in all of the times that we say it. And really, sometimes we say it so much we just forget the real content of the prayer. So I'm going to contend towards that goal this morning, because this prayer, it's said two times in the Gospels, and it's said at two different times in the ministry of Jesus. You know, in Jesus, he had 3 years on earth. He had a year, what they call preparatory year, and he had a year of popularity, and then he had a year of opposition. But if we think of those three things, especially the first two, the year of popularity, because when that prayer is said in the book of Matthew, Jesus is becoming very popular. He's contending for what theologians call active obedience. It's in those verses that Jesus says, "What I see the Father do, I do. What I hear the Father say, I say." And he was moving out, and it was obvious to anyone that came in contact with Jesus during this year of popularity that he was God, because nobody could do the things that he did if he wasn't God. But what's interesting about this prayer is it starts like this, It says, therefore, do not be like them. Because his first prayer, he's preaching. Now, in the second prayer, in the book of Luke, the 11th chapter, the disciples have appealed to Jesus for him to teach them to pray. So, in the Gospel of Matthew, we have the Lord's Prayer as preaching. In the Gospel of Luke, we have the Lord's Prayer as learning. Preaching and learning. The first one in the preaching is Jesus is very popular. And in his popularity, he starts this prayer by saying, do not be like them. And that's kind of a challenge because I was wondering about that. Who's he talking to when he said, be like them? And if you've been to Israel, I know a lot of you have, and the practice of disciples is to follow the rabbi, their teacher. And back in the day, and last time I was in Israel, they were still doing this. I don't know if they changed it because of all cyberspace and email and those things, so that the rabbi just says, we're not coming out to the guy's day, I'll text you the message. But back in these days, the rabbi was in the front and they would walk, and the disciples would walk behind, and they would lean forward just listening, trying to grasp every word that the rabbi was saying. But I kind of picture them as walking, and Jesus is leading them, and they're walking through Jerusalem, and then ever so often he would say, don't be like them. And he's pointing to somebody that's got the long face, and they're fasting. But they're fasting with the wrong motive. They're fasting to be seen. He does the same thing with people that are giving money. He would be walking and he would say, don't be like them. Because they were giving for the attention and the influence of those kinds of things. Jesus said, don't be like them. And also in praying, Jesus said, don't be like them. Because obviously there was people standing on the corner praying. And they were praying because it's really great for people to see people praying. But Jesus switches the message around. And in this preaching sermon, he says, this is what you do. If you're going to give, do it in secret. If you're going to fast, wash your face, get cleaned up. Don't look all gloomy so everybody will know what you're doing. And if you're praying, go into your closet and pray. He's preaching a sermon that says the prayer that Jesus gives is a very personal prayer. It's a prayer identified that we identify with, but the reward is, Jesus says, that when you go in secret with him and you pray, you give in secret, you fast in secret, you will be rewarded openly. Because what happens is when a person has that kind of a relationship with God in the quietness and in the person of their own heart, something happens that it changes the whole disposition of that person. I know of a lady, and I might have given this illustration before, that she was in Beaverton, and she had a very rough life. She had kids she was trying to support. She only worked part-time, made very little money, but she loved going to church, but she never got to go. She would go occasionally. But when she'd go to church, I knew the pastor, he said this, she would come to church, and when you look at her, she had a smile that was bigger than anybody else's in the church. He said that smile stood out so much that it confused him. He was asking himself, how can a woman going through that have a disposition that just bubbles with joy? It shook him up so much that he, after church, he pulled her aside. He used to pull her aside and said, what are you so happy about? Because he knew about her situation. And she said, well, Pastor, you know, I never get to be here. So what I do on Sunday mornings, I open up the paper, and he said, Pastor, you know, I've had a couple really bad marriages. I open up the paper and go to the page where all these people are getting married. And I lay my hand on that page, and I just start praying. That's all I can do. And she says, when I start praying for them, something happens inside of me. Something happens inside of me that fills me full of joy that I probably shouldn't have because of my situation. Now, I take that to mean what Jesus is talking about here. The giving, the praying, the fasting, that's not for everybody to see. But when we, in secret, and on our personal devotion time, draw nigh to God, we can't help but manifest in it openly to other people. And that's a beautiful truth. If you've discovered, you might know what I'm talking about. If you have times when you pray at home, and you're alone, and something happens in your heart that happens with actually only by virtue of the Word and God coming into the heart of a person. And that's what Jesus is saying here in this preaching. Okay? And then Jesus says, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, what does that mean? Because there's the kingdom, here's the earth, and he's saying, pray that that kingdom will come to this earth, but I find myself just caught in the middle. How do you live in the middle? Jesus is saying, pray that the kingdom will come down to earth, and his will be done on earth, but I just can't quite grasp the idea that it's here all the time. So he says, as you're living in the middle, there's the kingdom, here's the earth, you're connected with the kingdom, but the kingdom just isn't established, so here's how you live in the middle. You say, give us this day our daily bread. Now this could mean three things while we're living in the middle. It could mean food, that's like the ham and beef and hamburger you're going to eat after church, that kind of food. It could mean communion, the Lord's Supper, the breaking of the bread together. Or it could mean soul food. Give us this day our daily bread. Now, soul food is kind of what I was preaching about last Sunday, and I called it upper division discipleship. It's when you actually come to the place in your Christian life that you can feed your soul on the basis of God's word, because you know that there's nowhere to go for food because he has the words of eternal life. And I pray that we all come to a point in our life that we can eat that soul food. We can partake of him knowing that you're not going to get that kind of food anywhere you go. It's the kind of food that upper division discipleship says, I have nowhere to go for food, but you have the words of eternal life. To learn to live being sustained by the word of God in our hearts, in our lives, and also having our disposition changed, and in that becoming more conformed to the image of Christ every day by feeding the soul in his word. I like to think of it that way because I know in my life, I get really hungry sometimes, but it's not a hunger for food. It's a hunger for spiritual food, the word of God. And whenever I feast on that, everything is okay. But if I get hungry spiritually, I really get grumpy. Everything starts to affect you. I can shoot a fly with an elephant gun if I'm not in the Word. But feasting on the Word keeps things in check, and it nourishes and builds us up. And he says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Now, I call this altar time. Because this is relational. This is me and the Lord, and it's me and you. But did you know that the Lord intends you to have your own personal altar? And when you go to the altar and you pray, and it's a time of communion and prayer, time of edifying. But have you ever gone to the altar to pray, and you remember, you can't necessarily pray because you've got something in the back of your mind that relates to somebody else. This is the area of being forgiven and forgiving others, because if the forgiving of others doesn't happen, it tints our time at the altar. Because at the altar, you know, the way this prayer starts, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. That means his name is above everything. But many times in our prayer at our altar, it's not only his name, it's things that have infiltrated our minds, and we become so busy, or maybe somebody has said something, or what's worse, a person that's not a Christian has insulted us. And we forget that we have been forgiven. But when somebody that's not a Christian does something to a person, I mean, they cross a person that is a Christian, be by insult or anything else, the Christian has a tendency to take it personal. What we really should say, that person has no idea. They're clueless when it comes to forgiveness. But God's in my heart, and I'm not clueless. I know what it's like to really be forgiven because I have been forgiven. Therefore, whatever anybody else does to me, I'm forgiving them because my forgiveness is so great. The forgiveness for me far abounds probably anything that other people have been forgiving for. But rejoicing in forgiveness, of our personal forgiveness, keeps the altar fresh. Because we live in an age where there's all kinds of things trying to get our attention. Things happen, but just forgive us our debts as we forgive others. And doesn't the scripture say that when you go to the altar and pray, and if you have aught in your brother, and if somebody has aught against you, leave the altar. Go get it fixed. Then come back and begin to pray. Because we have to have not only the food from heaven, we have to have an altar. An altar that is fresh every day. And as we ascend to that altar, our minds are clear. If we've been hurt, we have forgiven. But the relationship with God is established on a clear understanding that we are the forgiven, therefore we can forgive. Okay. Do not lead us into temptation. That's the next one. Now this is how to live in the middle. Okay. You got heaven above, the kingdom above, coming to earth, but we're in the middle. And to live in the middle, it says, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Now, what does that mean? It means understanding that God does discipline, God does disciple in our lives. And there are things that God just deals with us. Things that are in our life that are doing us damage. And God says, well, we just can't have it that way, so we're going to help you out and let you be miserable. And then the thing that needs to be dealt with, you will eventually give it up. And you're being conformed to the image of Christ, but there are things that, it's a beautiful thing to understand that God will intervene in things in our life that are doing us damage. He'll come and he'll touch. It's a known thing in life. I mean, you can't get away from this if you're a Christian. There are different things. It's kind of like when the doctor told me my A1C is sky high. And at first I told him I felt real well, and I'm fine. And he says, well, let's take a blood test. They don't lie. Took a blood test and my A1C was high. And he's an honest man, looks you in the eye and he says, do you want the truth or you just want me to say everything's okay? And I just kind of says, give it to me, doctor. And he said, you're going to cut back the carbs. And I, what's carbs? Bread, spaghetti, potatoes. And I just kind of say, well, I thought that was all we ever had to eat. How can you live without carbs? But in his concern for me, he uses this other word too that was just drove me up the wall. He said, have you ever heard of the word portions? And I'm kind of saying, well, you know, this all really goes against the way I am. And he said, well, you're probably raised that way. And I said, yeah. My mom used to make a big bowl of spaghetti, put it in the middle of the table, and we would have garlic bread. And I would eat, and my dad would say, David, you're just glomming. And I don't know if there's even a word for glomming. But the way I was raised, you never left your plate empty. You ate it all the time. But now coming to a point of somebody that's really concerned, intervening, and say, we've got to work on this. Got to pull the carbs, eat portions. But it's not because they're angry. It's because he cares. But that's God intervening. It's a thing of living as part of God's living in the in-between. And we're going to make it because of that. Then he goes to say, for yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. It starts with the kingdom and it ends with the kingdom. But the way that it ends, it says that it's your kingdom. It's not my kingdom. It's his kingdom, not mine. Now, Jesus is preaching this. He's in the year of popularity. Not only is he teaching this, he's performing miracles. And it's becoming obvious to everybody. This guy is not like us. He is God, and he is proving it in his popularity, and people are following. He's doing miracles, and he's talking about the kingdom, and he tells us how to survive in the in-between. Okay? Now, that's the preaching part of what we call the Lord's prayer, or the disciples' prayer. That's to everybody. But now over in the Gospel of Luke, where this prayer is recorded again, and it's called the year of opposition. The opposition, it's the third year of the life of Jesus here on this earth. But now he has not actively obedience to his Father. Now things are starting to turn to what's called passive obedience. He's starting to not be so forward in his preaching and concentrating more on his teaching with his disciples. Okay, preaching, teaching, and it'd be teaching because the disciples are saying to him, Lord, teach us to pray. And Jesus responds. And he says, okay. And by the way, in the Gospel of Luke, between chapters 1 and 11, you always find places where Jesus is praying. He's just praying. He'd go up in the mountain to pray. He'd go in the wilderness to pray. He's just praying all the time. I think if the disciples were talking to each other and say, well, where's Jesus? And they'd probably say, oh, he's praying again. He prayed all the time. But then the disciples say, Lord, teach us to pray. And the rabbis had their own prayer for their following. And he says there, John taught his disciples to pray, Lord, you teach us to pray too. And then Jesus begins to teach the disciples to pray. And he says this, when you pray, say, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Once again, there is an isolating of the name of Jesus from every other name. And if you were ever in the service, I was in the Army, but I went from recruit, private, PFC, then back down to recruit. I just kind of went up and down all the time because I couldn't stay out of trouble. But and in the Army, you know, when you saw, like if you were in the dining room doing KP, where I was at a lot of time, an officer would walk in and you'd have to yell, "Officer on deck." Everything would get quiet until he said, "At ease." Then you'd go back to business. If you were walking down a hall and a captain came down the hall in front of you, you'd jump up against the wall and say, "Sir." Because by virtue of his rank, he was isolated by virtue of his rank, and everybody had to give him respect. There was no getting around it. He had the power to revoke a weekend pass just like that. But the respect, now what we're saying here about Jesus, thy name is holy. There's only one Jesus. And when we pray, all of that rank and everything that he is by virtue of being God incarnate deserves his name to be only one name, one person deserves that kind of rank. Jesus says, when you pray, pray like this: "Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name." There is no other name like that name on earth. And this teaching that Luke is given, now Matthew preaching, Luke teaching, the name of Jesus is above every name. There is none like him by virtue of who he is. He deserves and can lay claim to everything on this planet. That's who he is. And so the isolating of his name like that is the thing that Jesus taught. Now Jesus goes into, in Luke, in this teaching aspect, he goes also into the living in the in-between. That was the same thing that was said in his preaching. Preaching and teaching were the same when it came to how to live in the in-between. Bread, give us this bread, our daily bread. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. That kind of prayer that it's always on our hearts and our minds is to live in the middle between here and when we go home to be with the Lord. There's a plan on how we should live. And he said to them, now in Luke, it's not just living the in-between. Jesus gives a parable. And I want to read that to you. And this is right, he says, "But deliver us from evil." And he said to them, "Which of you shall have a friend and go to him at midnight and say to him, 'Friend, lend me 3 loaves. For a friend of mine has come to me on his journey. I have nothing to set before him.' And he will answer, from within and say, 'Do not trouble me. The door is now shut, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give to you.' I say to you, though he will not rise and give to him because he is his friend, yet because of his persistence, he will rise and give him as many as he needs." So we have a picture here. It's midnight, and this person has some visitors come. And back in the Middle East or back east, it's hot, so people travel at nighttime. You never know who's going to knock on the door at midnight. They're going to need a place to stay. And to not provide the needs of somebody that's coming to visit, it's violating what the Jews call the rule of hospitality. If somebody comes to your house, you're responsible, and they're there to visit, you're responsible to take care of them. Matter of fact, the Bedouins over in the Middle East, if you ever go over there, they'll have 3 tents. One's for the family, one's for eating, and there's one tent that's put up. It might not even be full, but it's put up just in case somebody comes by and they need hospitality. That's how much they believed in this rule of hospitality. So to be short on food when somebody knocks on the door is, and they're not going to be able to take care of somebody. It is a serious thing. Now, but if somebody says, looks out the window and says, "Look, it's midnight. I know you're my friend. It's midnight. And back here, most of the people slept in the living room. There would have been kids and parents scattered all over the living room sleeping. And they would say, look, it's midnight. I'm not coming down. The door's locked. In the Greek, that actually says the door's locked because it was meant to be locked. But because he's a friend, and because of the persistence of asking, you just don't quit knocking. You just keep on knocking, and eventually they'll come down and give you what you need. Because after all, they're a friend. And it's like, you just know, I know you, you're my friend, I need your help. Knock, 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 go away. No, knock, knock, knock. But because he's a friend, he will come down and he will give you your need. I don't know if this would apply to the first 7 years I was married. You wanted to buy a boat or you wanted to buy something, and you tell your wife, and she says, don't even think about it. And so you just kind of whine and dine and try to get your way, keep going. And if you whine long enough, that you'll just say, I don't care what you do, just get away from me, go do it. You know, just constantly nagging and it works. It used to work. If you nag long enough, she gets so sick of it that she'll just say, I don't care what you do, just get away from me and go do it. And then you walk away saying, works for me. But that's when you're newlyweds. Nowadays, if you ask for anything and it's no, it's no. That's the way it is. But this is a friend. And who doesn't have somebody that is a friend that wouldn't come down and help them in the middle of the night if they had a need? So Jesus says this, so I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be open. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be open. Then he says this, if a son, we're not talking about a friend, we're talking about a son. If a son asks for bread from any father among you, will he not respond? If your friend responds after all the begging and the needing of help, let's put the father in the place of the son and come to understand how willing he is to respond to your prayer. He doesn't have to be begged. You don't have to beat on the door forever. He is more than willing to meet the need. There's no petition. There's no whining. There's nothing. You think, if you have children, if they're in need, your heart just says, just ask. And you can have it. And in the asking, he doesn't only say that. He says, if a son asks for bread from any father among you, will he give him a stone? If he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent instead of a fish? Or if he asks for an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? Now you think about, I was thinking about that, and I was thinking, well, if I ask God for bread, he is only going to give me what is best for me. He doesn't give us things that will hurt us. But unfortunately, in our culture, we can say, well, he gives me these good things, but I want some other stuff that I'm not going to get by virtue of prayer. It's like, God, thanks for the bread, thanks for the fish, thanks for the egg, but I want a skidoo. I want a new truck. Or I want this. And we can begin to accumulate stuff that we haven't got through prayer. We got on our own. And if you're anything like me, you've bought a lot of things on your own that about 3 weeks later you think, oh boy, I wish I wouldn't have bought that. I saw a red Blazer one time in Lewiston. It was just like the Blazer was in this used car lot, and God was saying, "This is for you." And I didn't have the money to buy that thing, but I could finance it. And we went back up to Moscow, and I was thinking about it and pleading. And finally, I got it. And there's always this little bit of an uncomfortableness inside. And I got that red Blazer, and they had advanced the timing so that it sounded like it was running good. I took it home and timed it, and it knocked like a drum. But it wasn't something that God wanted me to have. It was something that I thought I needed. Rather than to be content with the things that God gives us, if we're not, He'll permit us to get things that we really don't need. And what happens then? Our time, our contentment, and those things that we have begin to take away from the time that we could have with Him if we're only receiving the things that He gives us through prayer. Let me promise you, you don't want anything from God that you didn't get by praying. If you didn't get it by praying, you're going to have to keep it going. But He has promised us to give us good, and His goodness is greater than having a lot of things that are just burdening us down and holding us down. Now we're going to come to the part that I think is my best. And when I was a kid, 12 years old, I can remember back that far, actually, because this occurrence or this incident happened. I played Little League Baseball. I was 12 years old. And there was a friend that I had. His name was Cleo. Cleo was 12 years old, too. And but Cleo was a real athlete. He was bigger than the other 12 years old. And whenever he played sports, everybody knew that Cleo would someday be a pro. That's how he was. And in Little League Baseball, he really liked to strut in it, too. In Little League Baseball, I played second base, and Cleo would go up to bat. When Cleo went up to bat, I would just turn around and say, "Back up. It's Cleo. Back up." Because when Cleo got there up the plate, something was going to happen, and it did this particular game. Because Cleo got up to bat, it was just the first pitch. He hit that thing, and it went further than the lights would show on the baseball diamond. And Cleo ran around all the bases. And he came by second base, and I said, "Well, great job, Cleo." And he goes by, and he goes home. Everybody's standing up in the stands, clapping their hands, and doing all this stuff. Teammate, you know how it is when the Mariners, ever so often the Mariners get a home run, and then just everybody jumps up, and they're really happy and everything. But that's what happened with Cleo. But there was a base coach behind me at second base. And the base coach said, "Get the ball and touch your base. Get your ball and touch the base." And I didn't understand what he said, but I went up to the pitcher and I said, "Give me the ball." The pitcher gave me the ball. I went back to second base. I touched the base, and the base umpire said, "You're out." Cleo had missed second base. Everybody was cheering. Everybody was happy. This big sportsman had made a great big impact on everybody, but he missed the base. Now, this next verse says this: "If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Holy Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him?" How much more will the Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him? And as I was going through this, I was thinking, Cleo's very impressive, does great things, but he missed second base. Everything he did was a lot of show and a lot of praise and a lot of admiration. but it didn't count for anything because he missed the base. Now, when I think of that in our lives, and if Jesus says, if Father would do that for you, how much more would he give the Holy Spirit to those that ask? How important is that? Well, why do people need the Holy Spirit in their life? Because if it's not of the Holy Spirit, we're missing the base. It's not God. It's just for show. But if it's the Holy Spirit, it's God. Now, why would it be the Holy Spirit? Let me read these scriptures. Therefore, there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and on account of sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Why do we need the Spirit? Because it's what delivers us from the law. And we're free because of his Spirit in our life. If we don't have the Spirit in our life, we're missing second base. No matter what's going on, the Holy Spirit to us, if we just simply ask. This another verse here, Romans 5, 1-5. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace through God, our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in hope and the glory of God. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulation, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. Now, hope does not disappoint because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. Galatians. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, peace, joy, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. And those who are in Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. And if we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit, and let us not become conceited, provoking one another to envying one another. But the Spirit is asked for because we have a Father who desires to pour his Spirit in our heart. And Romans says, his Spirit bears witness with our spirit, and we cry out, Abba, Father. Without the Holy Spirit, we're missing second base. He is the one who bears witness with us that we're the children of God and gives us the capacity. He is in us manifesting himself that does what only the Spirit of God can do. Now, everything can really look good. You know, somebody told me when I came to church today that, man, you really look nice. And I thought, well, thank you. But when you're up here looking, you have to have more than looking nice. And every one of us, we need more than how we look. We need the Spirit of God in our hearts, and we have access to him because he is the Father who is more than willing to give it to us if we just ask him. And I've been really counting on this because before I do anything that really scares me, I just say, Lord, give me your Holy Spirit. And he says, I will. Then I say, well, how come I'm still shaking so much? But if he gives you the Holy Spirit and you say, okay, I'm going to believe that, and I'm going to have faith that what you've promised, you will do. And when I get over it, my biggest obstacle in life is getting over myself. And if I will have faith in his Holy Spirit in me, something miraculous happens. As I get this blessed part in my life of just getting over me. And his spirit, the fruit of his spirit, and everything that he is, bears witness in a life, and you can live a life of victory in him, not being opposed or encroached on by things in this world. So, the preaching, Jesus is telling, don't be like this, don't be that kind of, you know, if you're going to pray, don't stand on a corner, pray in your closet. If you're going to give, don't give publicly, give in private. If you're going to pray, don't pray so everybody can see you. Pray in private. And when you pray in private, he comes to you and builds you up inside in his spirit. And then you can walk in newness of life in him without the contaminants of this world messing with your head. It's in him. But I think I would like to go and just say with confidence and everything is that if you ask the Lord for his spirit in any situation, and no matter how you feel, you believe it, you'll experience these things that I just read about his spirit, because he is more than willing to give his presence to us in our hearts. And we encounter things all week when we that cause us problems. But if you pray, you know, I've just hypothetical things come into our mind, but if we say, Lord, I need your spirit, I need your presence, and have faith in that, he, by his spirit inside, will help us to not only get through, but get through victoriously. So right now, we're going to pray the Lord's Prayer, and I'll pray it. And you want to stand for this, please, and you can pray along with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. And Lord, it is within the context of this prayer for Kayla Flagan, who's in the hospital, struggling through a pregnancy. We ask you, Lord, to give your presence and your love to her. And for LaVarne Lewis, who has health issues, Lord, we lift her up before you and ask you to touch her in her heart. And also, Lord, we pray for all the people that are out fighting fires in our county. We ask you to encourage them, give them strength, let them not become so disappointed. But Father, give a quick resolve to all the smoke and the fires. And we trust you for this and for you to do this. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
benediction. I would like to say that to go out in every difficulty, every situation, every anxiety, every frustration, you say, Lord, give me your spirit. Give me your spirit that I might stand in forgiveness, the fruits of your spirit, delivered from the law, walking in newness of life in you. And as we encounter difficulties, to know that greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. So go in that blessing. In Jesus' name.
Enjoy this beautiful